Well, we're going to start a new study. More light up here for me, if you can. I'm going to start a new study, and we're going to look at the book of 1 Peter. So go way to the right in your Bible, way to the right. If you need a Bible, maybe just raise your hand. Somebody will bring you a Bible. 1 Peter, way to the right. You're going to go through the big book of Hebrews, James, and then you're going to come to 1 Peter. Little bit of background. This book is written by Peter. That's right. Some of you weren't sure. You thought, oh, I don't want to make a mistake. No, it's written by Peter. I wouldn't ask you a question that make you look dumb, okay? So 1 Peter is written by Peter. That implies that there are how many letters at least? There's going to be another one, 2 Peter. And these letters are written by Peter. His brother, of course, we know was Andrew, right? You got it. They were both, what was his vocation? BC. He was a fisherman. Jesus said, I like that skill set, but you're going to use them and you're going to become fishers of men, he said. So Peter, you know how to throw the nets. You know how to, you know, bring things in. And so he says, I'm going to do the same thing with you, only this is not going to be for food that can perish. It's going to be for eternal things. And so we're going to be fishers of men. I just want you to think about Peter and his life a little bit, because I think as I read through 1 Peter, and I would encourage you now that you know where we're going, is that this week and maybe every week, you just read through 1 Peter and get it under your belt, so to speak. But I like to think about Peter, who he was, the high points of his life. It seems like the low points are what everybody remembers. I'm glad that my history isn't written in the Bible, because there would be a lot of low points, huh? We all make those kind of mistakes. But we know that Peter was a man who loved Jesus with all his heart. He wanted to do the right thing. He wanted to have the answers. Remember when Jesus says, well, who do people say that I am? And they said, well, some people say you're like this, you're this, this, this. And then Jesus says, but who do you say I am? And Peter said, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus said, that's right, Pete, he said. But flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And then we're all aware of how Peter denied Jesus. How many times? Yeah, three times he denied Jesus. Jesus had predicted that. So just keep that in mind. But after the resurrection of Jesus, Peter was still feeling so bummed that he was basically kind of staying away. You know how it is when you've let the Lord down, and we have all done that. Okay, the person next to you that you think is so good, all right, unless they're your spouse. We have all let Jesus down. And Peter, because he thought he had blown it so bad, Peter just kind of wanted to stay away. And Jesus made the overture to him. Jesus came to Peter and he said, remember, he says, Peter, do you love me? And I wonder if Peter just kind of cringed, because when he was asked by those people that were around the fire while Jesus was being tried, he was outside with part of the group that were, you know, watching with critical of Jesus and wanted to see him condemned. When he was out there, he had denied Jesus. They said, you're one of them. And he says, I don't know the man. I don't know the man. You know, three times. Finally, he cursed, you know, he cussed, you know, I blankety blank, don't know him. At that point, the scripture says Jesus looked at him. He looked down where Peter was, and Peter went out, and the Bible says he wept bitterly. I don't think the look of Jesus was one of terrible condemnation, or I think there would have been two suicides that night. You know, Judas committed suicide, but I think Peter might have too if Jesus had given him that kind of a look. I think that when we sin, I think Jesus does see it. I don't think Jesus... It grieves Jesus when we do that. And there's nothing that a Christian wants to do. Well, let me say this. No Christian wants to grieve Jesus. When you know him, you don't want to do that to him. But when we do, you know, there's that look. Getting back to Peter, the last thing had happened was Jesus had, you know, that was his experience. It's still in his mind. And so Jesus said, do you love me? And he says, Lord, you know that I love you. But three times he asked Peter if he loved him. And Jesus said, then feed my sheep, feed my lambs, all right? And so Peter was commissioned as one of the apostles of Jesus. Now, this letter that we're looking at is from the apostle Peter to a group of churches in Asia Minor. And Peter, of course, is the author. He's writing about AD 62 to 64. So if we say Jesus rose from the dead, let's say 33 AD. So it's about three decades after the resurrection of Jesus. And there were real turbulent times that were starting to happen in the Roman Empire. Tough times. People felt this sense of dis-ease. They felt like, hey, something's coming, you know. Society is in a bad way socially. Whole Roman Empire. Socially, economically, politically, religiously, there was this waiting for the foot to fall. You know, something's wrong. Things are going to explode. There was already a sense of doom. And the church didn't know it. Peter's writing this to them. And Peter didn't know it either, unless the Holy Spirit had shown it to him supernaturally. But Peter's writing this letter to a church that is about to go into one of the worst persecutions that the Christian church has ever had in its history. So I want you to look at this letter, remembering that this is being sent now to people who are going to suffer greatly. They don't know it yet. But Peter is writing to them something that will give them courage and comfort and even a sense of purpose in the suffering that they're going to go through. You see, in AD 64, Rome burned. Now, the Christians were becoming a concern to the Roman emperor his name was Nero. I think we've all heard of Nero. Nobody names their sons Nero. We name our dogs. I wouldn't even name my dog Nero, would you? Come here, Nero. You know, I mean, that's a name that just, it's gone down in history as a horrible name. It's like a Hitler, you know, something like that. And so Nero saw the Christian church as a threat because, you know, there were almost 500,000 Christians in Rome at this time. Man, the church had grown in 30-some years from zero Christians in Rome to 400,000. Somebody said, wow, that's pretty cool, isn't it? That's huge growth. And so it's affecting society. There's some of these believers that are in Caesar's household. They're servants of Caesar. Some of them are in the military, real close to Caesar. And so it's infiltrating the empire. And so the emperor, he wants to clear some land too because he wants to build some palaces. And there's the slums and people's houses. They were burned out. Made out of wood, and so somebody set a fire. Most people believe now it was Nero himself. He sent somebody to set the fire, but the city, a large portion, burned down. So they're looking for a scapegoat. Nero wanted to deflect the blame off himself, and so he blamed those Christians for burning down the city. Now, there was already talk going around about Christians, misinformation about Christians. Wow, that still happens today, doesn't it? People think they know what Christians are, they know how they believe, they know what they do. And see, in the first century, there were three things that Christians were accused of. It may shock you. Christians were accused by people in the Roman Empire of being atheists. What? We believe in God, right? How many believe in God? We're in the first century Rome, okay? We believe in God. No, Caesar is God. They had lots of gods. They had Zeus, you know, they had all these other gods. But Caesar was God. He represented Rome. And Christians refused to worship the emperor. Therefore, they were atheists. You don't believe in God. You're atheists. So that was the word on the street about Christians. They're atheists. The second thing was they were cannibals. I know that sounds weird, but tell me why. because when they would get together, they would do this thing where they would take bread and they would say, "This is my body." They would take wine and they would say, "This is my blood." And the pagans said, "Look, man, they're eating." And you know how it goes from one person to another person to another person. And pretty soon, the accusation was disgusting. They're disgusting, atheistic, cannibalistic. And the third thing, they were perverts. Why is that? Because they called the dinner that they had an agape feast. What does that word mean? Love. Now, it wasn't an eros feast, which is lust kind of thing, but this was an agape feast. And so, you know, it seems like if unbelievers can take something, now let me put this a little better way. It seems that it's easy for our faith to be misrepresented, and that's why it's so important for us not to just go in and hunker down in the bunker, but we need to get out there and we need to talk the truth. Amen. This is how Christians really are. This is what we really believe about these issues. These are really our attitudes. This is really what we believe about Jesus. And so, a little bit more intro. The reason for the letter is given here at the end. You'll see in chapter 5, verse 12, that the Apostle Paul says, now, I'm telling you why I wrote the letter. So this is all summed up. We know because he tells us. I like that when, you know, there's no doubt. He says, hey, I've got Silvanus here helping me to write the letter. I don't know if that, we think maybe Paul didn't see very well. Maybe there was something because he couldn't see, couldn't write very well. You know, then have glasses in those days. But so Silvanus is writing it down, and Paul is dictating the letter to him. And he says, through Silvanus, our faithful brother, for so I regard him, I have written to you briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God. Then what does he say? Stand firm in it. Let's say it together. Stand firm in it. This is the true grace of God. Now, what? Stand firm in it. And then he says, she who is in Babylon, that's the code name for Rome. Okay, you can't have the Romans. Now, you know, at this point, things, you know, I say troubles are brewing. And so the code name for Rome is Babylon. So she who is in Babylon, that's believers in Rome, chosen together with you, send you greetings. And so does my son, Mark. Now, if you remember, Paul and Barnabas had a problem over Mark, and Mark got timid and he wanted to skedaddle home, and as a result, Paul said, hey, I'm done with him, you know. And for a while, Paul and Barnabas separated over this and they went their own ways preaching the gospel. But then we see Mark coming full circle, and now he's one of Paul's right-hand guys. And so that's just another evidence of that. Okay, well now let's look at this, because we're going to see what people who are in trouble need to know. So let's just begin reading. And I'm reading from the New American Standard Version. I apologize for going back to my mother tongue here, but my notes are in this Bible, and I can no longer write as tiny as I used to write. And these, in fact, I had to get a magnifying glass to be able to read my notes that are in my Bible, but we'll see here what happens. So he begins, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who were chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be yours in fullest measure. What an awesome way to begin. I could never start. Mine are just, dear Ben, how are you? You know. And I end with a God bless you. But this is like inspired almost. Oh, it is inspired, right? So Peter, he announces who he is. He has the authority. He is who? An apostle of Jesus Christ. An apostle, the word apostolo, it means to be sent. So he's a sent one. Peter, I'm commissioned by God. I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. And he's writing to those who reside as aliens. An alien. Well, we talk about aliens. I'm not talking about, the ones in outer space. But, you know, we talk about people who aren't native to a country and that really isn't their own. They don't have the passport, you know. And he's saying, I want you to understand, and we need to know this, that this world, if you look at your passport, is not your home. All right? I have a passport. And it's wherever you go with your passport, it's stamped by the country you go into, right? But then you always come back to your homeland. I've had some interesting occurrences trying to get back home. I can usually get out okay. But the coming back, I don't know, customs pulls me over. I must look like somebody that needs to be pulled over, you know? And twice I've been taken to that room, pulled away. The guy will be smiling to my wife, to the kids, coming in. Not you. What? And you don't want to say too much because you think, well, that'll just make you look like a bad guy. Okay, follow me. And so you're following your family's waving goodbye. You know, it's like, you follow them. Now you know the camera's following you as well, you know, the security camera. So you go in, please sit here. So one time I was in the room, they shut the door. And I was like, oh my goodness. What did I pay my traffic ticket? What could it be? And I waited for like 45 minutes. And then finally, they said, oh, you can go. I was like, dude, why did this happen? But you don't want to ask that either because, you know, they might, why are you asking? Okay, thank you, you know, I appreciate it. That's happened to me 2 times trying to get back in the United States. And I'm not an alien. This is my home. But all of that to go back to the fact that our passports do not say this world. If you're a Christian, your passport says heaven. All right. So don't be surprised if you get pulled over now and then and people say, hey, this, what are you doing here? This doesn't belong to you. Because we are aliens in this world. In fact, Jesus, he says in John, let me read to you what he says. You write the note down right by this, by aliens, okay? This is John 15, 18, and 19. Jesus says, if the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, listen to this. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Jesus says, you know, a great sign that you don't belong to this world is the world just doesn't like you. Now, I don't think that we should ask for people to not like us. I don't think that we should be weird, that we should ever be hateful, though we have to talk about what we stand for, what the Bible believes, of course. But let's not ever get the idea that the world eventually is going to say, we're all just great. All right? That's not going to happen. Because he didn't say that about Jesus. And if Jesus couldn't get along with everybody, are you going to get along with everybody? If Jesus couldn't please everybody, are you going to be able to please anybody? Hello? No. If the world hated Jesus, believe me, there's a lot more reason for the world to be bugged at us now and then. And it has nothing to do even with our teaching. It's just we're fallen, sinful people. So he says he's writing to those who are aliens throughout Asia Minor. Now he says, I am an apostle of Jesus Christ. We are chosen, verses aren't always put in the right place. We are chosen, verse 2, we're chosen. How are we chosen, gang? How are we chosen? It says it right in the top of verse 2. According to the what? Foreknowledge of God the Father. I just want to say a little bit of something here. There's a lot in Christianity, and it's pretty much a real ongoing debate right now. And it is between what I would call a free grace theology, which is what we teach, and a Reformed theology. Reformed theology goes back to a church theologian way back when, whose name was John Calvin. He wore the jeans for the first time. No, I'm kidding. John Calvin. You get me sitting down and I relax, don't I? So John Calvin, John Calvin, he had a system wherein he kind of put in a box every single thing. He tried to explain everything without having there real any intention in Scripture. And there are tensions in the Bible. Does God know who's going to be saved before they're saved? Yes, because he knows all things. But does God give a choice to those who are going to be saved? Yes. So how do you put the things together? Well, in some ways I can. In other ways, I can't figure God out. God must be bigger than we are, right? That's the kind of God we want. We don't want one of those Greek or Roman gods that live just like, you know, they were gods that they were having sex together. They had illegitimate children. They were always jealous and fighting one another. Our God isn't like that. He's holy. And we are not going to understand God all the way because he says, for my ways are not your ways, okay? My thoughts are not your thoughts. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so are my thoughts. You know, that you're not going to comprehend all the way of thinking. But this does tell us, our Reformed theology, and this is kind of in a thumbnail sketch, and we could spend a couple of weeks, and I don't want to do that, but it's the concept that some people are chosen by God before they're born to be saved. Other people are chosen by God before they're born to be damned. Okay, so you don't know if that little baby that you have in the nursery right here has been chosen by God to be saved or chosen by God to be damned. And the person has nothing to do with it. You have no choice. It's all by God's election, by God's choice, by his predestination, and that's that. However, this verse tells us that we're chosen by the foreknowledge of God the Father. God knows who will receive him. Given free will, which Adam and Eve had in the garden, right? God did not foreordain that Adam and Eve should sin. There was a choice. Eat the fruit of the tree and don't live, or don't eat of it and what? Live. There was a choice. And so free will is so important. Because if only people who were forced by God to be saved were saved, God is then being worshiped by, it's kind of like robots. Well, I'm worshiping God because I've been created by God. I'm not worshiping God because I have a free will. Now, I do think of a scripture that Paul writes to Timothy, and it's found, I'll just read it to you, in 1 Timothy chapter 2. And he says that God, our Savior, desires, 1 Timothy 2, 3 and 4, God desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. You see, it's God's desire for all people to be saved and not just for a certain group that have been predestined to be saved and others have been predestined to be lost. For that reason, I don't want to spend a lot of time on that, okay? There's a lot of info and other messages that we've done on that. I just want you to see now who's involved in saving us. Look at verse 2. We've been saved according to the foreknowledge of God the, who? Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be yours with fullest measure. So who's involved in our salvation? The Trinity, right? The Father choosing us. And you know, if you're chosen by God, if you're saved, you're chosen by God. God the Father had foreknowledge. He looked forward to you being born. The Holy Spirit has sanctified you. The word sanctified means to set aside. not to like push you aside, but it means to set aside something for a special purpose. This chair is set aside. Let's say only I was going to sit in this chair, okay? So this chair has been sanctified for Mark, all right? This is sanctified for me. And so when you were saved, the Holy Spirit sanctified you to Jesus. Now, think about what we've been told, like in, in Ephesians, that the Holy Spirit has come into our lives and has sealed us. That means that we've become God's own unique possession, and nobody can have us but God. So you've been sealed, saved, brothers and sisters. You've been set aside for God, amen? And then it says, Jesus has sprinkled his blood on us. It says, we have obeyed Jesus and been sprinkled with his blood. The obedience here, obeying Jesus, is having faith in Jesus. Other places in the New Testament, the obedience of faith is spoken about. So what can we do? We place our faith in Jesus, and then we're saved. Okay, so that's the obeying Jesus. Everybody follow me there? So it's not a work you do, because by grace we've been saved through faith. And that faith is not even from us. The faith is what? A gift of God. So nobody can boast. We can never go to heaven and say, I did anything to get saved. We just say, God, it's all about God. Amen? So we've been saved, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We've been sprinkled with Jesus' blood. And now he begins this doxology. Doxos in Greek means to praise. And so this huge praise. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Bless God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who's caused us to be what? Born again. Now that's a Jesus term. Because when Nicodemus came to Jesus, John chapter 3, and he says, what good thing should I do? You know, no, that was the ruler. When he says, he came to Jesus, he had a question, and Jesus says, you must be born again. So that's a Jesus term. And he says, you've been born again. We're not the person we used to be before Jesus. You've been born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. What guarantees our salvation? The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Nobody else has risen from the dead and lived eternally. Amen. And so when Jesus says, I'll save you if you place your faith in me, Jesus is saying, I guarantee it, I back it up with my life, my risen life. His resurrection is the receipt that eternal life is ours. Jesus cried out, it is finished on the cross, which means paid in full, all our sins were paid for. He was buried, he rose 3 days later, and that resurrection is the receipt. And so we all have partaken in Christ's resurrection who believe in him. Now, we have, verse 4 says, an inheritance. Now, I don't know if any of you have received an inheritance, but when you get an inheritance, it's something you didn't earn, and it's something that somebody gives you because they have what? Passed away. They've died. And so due to the death of Jesus, though he's alive now, we have an inheritance. But it's not something that you can spend away. It's something that is yours eternally. Look at what he says. To obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. Man, I could just chew on all of that. It's imperishable. That means it cannot what? Perish. It is undefiled, won't fade away, and it's reserved as a word kept in heaven for you. No, you can't sit at this table. This is reserved, right? This is an eternal life reserved from you. You have a place at the table, all right? And it's your name is on that resume. Ever been to a banquet that's so special that your name is on a card? Anybody? Anybody? Just a few of us are that special, huh? I've even saved the card. I go to Olive Garden and I put it on my table, you know. I'm just teasing. But, you know, reserve, this is kept for you. God has kept this for you through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In fact, see, when Jesus returns, our eternal salvation is going to be completely revealed. And he says in verse 6, five, who are protected by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Verse 6, in this you greatly rejoice. It means to exalt. It means to celebrate. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while. Now he's turning the corner, and he's going to talk about what's going to start coming their way. Even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. The word for distressed here actually means to be brought down, to be bummed out, to be caused sorrow. All right? Now, I know that there are some Christians that kind of make me feel that if I'm going through a tough time and I'm sad, that I'm somehow not very spiritual. Come on, brother, praise the Lord anyway. Well, you know what? Shut up, all right? Just shut up. You make me feel worse. I'm not feeling good. That's not exactly what I need. Maybe you could come alongside me and say, oh, man, you know, let me pray, you know, but don't praise the Lord anyway, me, okay? Yes, I understand I have reason to praise and all, but Peter is even recognizing that there is a sorrow in the midst of this, the trials, various trials, and that the proof of your faith is more precious than gold. Now he's talking about, okay, the fire's turning up, all right? Things are heating up, and he uses the analogy of gold. Now, gold doesn't come out looking, you know, necessarily like what you're wearing. You know, if you're wearing a necklace or a bracelet or a ring or something, it has to be mined, it has to be crushed, then it has to go in the fire. And all the impurity, it's called dross. All the dross has to be burned off, and they keep scraping off the dross that floats to the surface until you have pure gold. And it's been said, how do you know when it's pure enough? It's when you can see your reflection in it. And there's a lot of times in our life where Jesus is refining us. He's refining us because he wants the impurities to be burned off, because he wants us to look more and more like him and be more and more like him. And so he says, the proof of your faith, this refining, like in the fire that gold goes through, of your faith, being more precious, even more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. You go through the sufferings and the trials and the tough stuff you're going through right now, and that is going to give Jesus praise and honor and glory when he returns. And then verse 8, and though you have not seen him, you what? Love him. Now, I haven't seen Jesus. I mean, not physically. Maybe some of us have had dreams. Maybe someone's had a vision of Christ. But you really haven't personally seen Jesus, most likely. And he said, remember with Thomas, and Peter probably has this in mind because Thomas wasn't at church when he should have been. You know, the evening after the resurrection of Jesus, the disciples are all gathered in the upper room. Remember the story? They were all scared. Same thing that happened to Jesus was probably going to happen to them. So they're freaked out. And then Jesus appears. And they all realize it's the Lord. He's alive. this is crazy. And, you know, Jesus, this is what I said I'd do, you know. But it's like us. Sometimes we just don't get it. And so who wasn't there? Thomas. And so when Thomas, who wasn't at church, so to speak, they're saying, Thomas, you missed it. What? You missed the best service that we've ever seen in our lives. Isn't that the way it is too? You have 100% church record and you miss one time and people are talking about, oh man, that was the best. You know, and it wasn't recorded either for some reason. There was a mistake. And it'll never happen again. But it was Thomas. Jesus was here. And Thomas' response was, I doubt that, right? I doubt that. And the next week, Tommy happened to be at church, didn't he? And this time Jesus appeared. I mean, he was in the room. And Jesus appeared and he says, Thomas? He says, come and touch the nail, the prints in my hands and in my side, the spear place in my side where the spear was. And don't be unbelieving anymore, but believe. And Thomas, you know, was overwhelmed and he fell down before the Lord and he says, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said to him, and this is my point, he says, Thomas, you believe because you've seen. That's okay, but blessed are those who believe who have not seen. You know, that's a blessing that comes right down to tonight. A special blessing of Jesus saying, you haven't seen me, but you believe. You see, that's a special blessing that Jesus places on you tonight. And though you have not seen him, you love him, reading on. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but you believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. And as to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful search and inquiry, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and his glories to follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you, in these things which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Okay, this is how we're going to distill this. He's saying, and by the way, remember, Jesus was prophesied by the Old Testament prophets. And there's all these prophecies about Jesus. Why should I believe in Jesus? Not because grandma or mom and dad believe in Jesus, though I wouldn't discount that. The reason why I believe in Jesus is because the Bible validates belief in Jesus. How? The Bible has this amazing self-validating feature, and it's in every translation. And it is called prophecy. And so what happens is the Bible, the inspired prophets of God, will make a prophecy. And you know, nobody sat down and wrote the Bible. Let's have a Bible writing time. And everybody gets together and write. No, these are over thousands of years written by different people. Some of them the same topic, but they're written, you know, hundreds of years apart. They're predicting things that are exact, that are amazingly exactingly, perfectly correct. For instance, some of the prophecies Peter's referring to here, he says, the Spirit of Christ was moving the prophets to write things about the Messiah that they didn't understand. Well, some of the things they wrote about are the prophecies that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. You know, there's a prophecy that says the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. That he would be, he would come from the lineage of an old family in Israel, the family of Jesse through David, and it would go on down that line. It says that he would be hunted down, and his family would have to run to Egypt after he was born. It says that the Messiah then would come back from Egypt and live in Galilee. Galilee of the Gentiles. It says that he would be a Nazarene. It says that he would work miracles in the Galilee area. It predicts that all of this had to happen before the destruction of the second temple in AD 70. So you have to find somebody who fulfills all these prophecies before AD 70, which means it could be nobody after then. It says that the Messiah would be, I'm paraphrasing, but it describes his crucifixion in Psalm 22, 1,000 years before crucifixion was invented. He's pierced through his hands, his feet. He's crying out on the cross. Psalm 22, 1 says, my God, the Messiah prophecy says he will cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's what Jesus cried out on the cross. Isaiah 53 describes his crucifixion. The book of Psalms talks that the Messiah will be resurrected because it says you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. His body would not begin to decompose. I'm just giving you highlights, all right? I could sit down and for 3 hours we could look at the predictions of the Messiah in the Old Testament. See, there's a reason why I believe. It even tells us in Daniel the exact day Jesus would enter Jerusalem. It predicts he would be mounted on a donkey. It gives us the exact day in history, and we know it is the day, you go back and you figure it out, when Jesus would come in to the gates of Jerusalem on what we call Palm Sunday. So why do I believe in Jesus? Well, I still have faith, you know, but I believe because there's a huge amount of evidence in the Bible. This book is amazing. It's an amazing book. It's inspired by the Spirit of Christ, as it says right here. But these holy prophets, they didn't really know. They wanted to know, who is this? It's the Messiah, but when? When is this going to happen? And he's probably referring to the prophet Daniel, that when, Lord, is this going to happen? And that's when the Lord did give Daniel that prophecy that predicts the exact day of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. But they realized, this isn't for us. We're not going to see it. But Peter says, they realize it wasn't for them, but it's for you. You've heard the good news that these prophecies predicted. You've heard it, and you've believed. And by the way, angels are totally looking into this. They're going, we don't get all of this. I'm very respectful of angels. You know, I've seen a couple angels in my day. And maybe I'll tell you a story about it sometime, remind me, you guys. But so I know that angels exist. But it says our salvation, they are, what does it say? It says they long to look into it, don't they? It's like, wow. And I don't know, respectfully, if they're thinking, are you kidding me, Mark? Lord, you're so good to Mark. They're scratching their head. I doubt it, because the Bible says every believer here, you have an angel assigned to you. Do you know that? Every one of you, you have an angel assigned to you. Some of them are very busy. Some of them are busy keeping you from temptation. You know, there's spiritual fights going on all the time. They're protecting you. There are near misses. Man, we could tell our stories, couldn't we? They can only be explained by some supernatural thing protecting us, okay? So these are things that angels, Hebrews 1, 14 or so, says that the angels are ministering spirits, and they've been sent to minister to us, who are the heirs of salvation. Now, I want to take a moment and talk about our security as believers. There are some people, and I was raised, you guys, I was raised till I was about 20, I believe this, till about 28, 18, 20 years old, that I could lose my salvation. And I, you know, one week I'd be saved, I'd go along, you know, as a young guy, young man, I'd go along great, and then I'd do something or something would happen, and then I'd sin, and I'd need to get re-saved. And, you know, they give an altar call, and it would be for salvation. I'd come forward and need to be re-saved again. Saved and lost, saved and lost, saved and lost. I call it eternal insecurity, all right? And you know what? This is what I began to feel like. And a lot of my friends that were in high school, a lot of my friends in college, they're not having anything to do with God because they had the view that God, their salvation was based upon something they did do, and they were honest enough to know that and say that they're not perfect. And so if God demands them to be perfect in order for them to be saved or kept saved, they're honest. They say, this doesn't work for me. And they've walked away from God, all right? I was near that point, but then just by the love of God, some friends shared the gospel with me, and I began to understand that, you know what? I'm not saved by anything that I do. I'm saved by what Jesus has done for me. And so God is pleased with Jesus, and so God is pleased with me, all right? And that's amazing to me. But let's look at how we know that our salvation is safe. Okay, I just want to point this out, and I'll do so quickly, and it'll just take us a second. But it says in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be what? Born again." Then I see, how was I born again? Look at verse 23. For you have been born again, not of seed which is perishable, but imperishable. That is through the living and abiding word of God. And he says, for all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God abides how long? Forever. And so, you know, living here in the desert, we see how quickly some rain falls and the flowers pop up, but then it gets, you know, 2 weeks later it's hot and they all fade, right? And he says, you know, that's not the way your salvation is. You've been born again by the imperishable word of God. You heard the word, you heard it and believed, and you were born again by the Holy Spirit taking that. Now, when you were born imperishably, that means you cannot what? Perish. That means what you have, if you're born again, is eternal and you cannot lose it. How can you be unborn? Right? If I'm born again with imperishable seed into Christ's family, I cannot get unborn. That's a thought. Think about that. The next thing he says in verse 4 is that we have an inheritance, which is what? Imperishable. There's that word again. Undefiled, will not fade away, reserved where? In heaven. It's not in your hands. My reservation, my being kept, is in heaven. Somebody in heaven is keeping me. And you know what I think Peter was thinking about? I think Peter was thinking about when Jesus said, hey, Peter, Satan he desires to sift you like wheat. He wants to destroy you, but I've prayed for you so that your faith will not fail. I think Peter understands the fact that, you know, the only thing that kept me saved was Jesus praying for me. Jesus prayed for me, and because he is praying for me right now, I'm saved, I'm secure, I'm born again, I can't get unborn again, and this next thing is my most favorite thing in this section of Peter, and look at this. This is awesome. You ready? Verse 5, who are protected by the power of God through faith for salvation. Who's protecting me? God by his what? Power. And think about the power of God for a minute. I mean, we can't talk about it too much, but just think about the power of God. God's power is what he knew? Keeping you saved. It's not your power. It's God's power keeping you saved. And that word kept by the power of God, note that word. This is my favorite thing. Kept. is an ancient word that was used for a fortress where you could go in and the doors could be locked and you couldn't get out. All right? It's a fortress, something with walls around it. Later, and by this time, it came to mean somebody, let's say a prisoner who was guarded by soldiers and he could not get away. That's the word kept. So kind of look at this. You are kept by the power of God. You are fortressed around by the power of God. God has you protected like he's got soldiers guarding you, and you're not going to get away from him. Who wants to say amen to that? Amen. Praise the Lord for that. Amen. Now, I want us to turn and look now at verse 18. It says, knowing through this, he says, now knowing this, that you are not redeemed with, here's that word again, perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life. And that's what life was like, BC, right? It was futile. From our futile way of life inherited from our forefathers. But you were redeemed with what? Precious blood, as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. You know, when those people would bring an offering for their sins, they would bring a sacrifice before Jesus. And when they would bring the sacrifice, they would bring a lamb. And they would bring a lamb and they would bring it to the temple, and it would be a perfect lamb, no blemishes, perfect lamb. And they would place their hands on top of that lamb's head and they would confess their sin. And then give the lamb to the priest, and the priest would nick the lamb's little jugular vein and the lamb would pass out. And its blood would be caught in a container, and then the blood would be taken onto the altar and be poured out on the altar. All right? That blood of that sacrifice took away their sins. When Jesus came, his cousin, so I'm coming to the river to be baptized, John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus came and has redeemed us with his precious blood.
Thanks for joining us online to watch one of our messages. I hope it was encouragement to you. Before you click off the tab and continue with your day, I want to invite you to partner with us with your financial blessing and offering and gifts to the Lord. You can find our giving button right above us on the upper right-hand side of the screen. We hope that we're able to continue to bless you in the future. God bless.